Welcome to Swatantra Education. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about the fundamental building blocks of programs. There are two basic aspects of programming. One is data, another one is instruction. So to work with data, you need to understand variables and types. Similarly, to work with instructions, you need to understand what is control structure and what is subroutine. So first we will discuss what is a variable. So variable is just a memory location. You can consider variable is like a memory location, and this memory location has been given a name, or simply you can just consider, or you just need to keep in mind that variable refers to a kind of box in memory location similar to this that can hold data. So for example, we can say this box contain 5 and the name of the variable is x. So here we can say this 5 is the value of the variable and this x is the variable name. A variable has also a type that indicates what sort of data it can hold. So each variable has a type. We have different types that indicate the category of data a variable can store. Suppose for example, one type is integer. That is going to store or hold only integer values, for example 3, 5, minus 2, 0, like this. Another type of variable hold floating point numbers, for example floating point numbers, for example 3.46, 7.5, 2.41, like this. So these are the numbers with a decimal point, 3.46, 7.5, 2.41, or similarly you can write 12.59, like this. So we have also another type for individual characters like A, B, C, small a, small b, like this, semicolon, like this. So these are the types that hold individual characters or letter. Individual characters or letters. We have also the types for strings. So another type is string. Suppose for example hello, like this, hello Java, etc. So you can observe this, the letters or individual characters are written inside a single quote like this, but the strings are written inside double quote like this, hello Java, like this. And a string can include many characters. So here hello is a string, so that contains 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 characters. Similarly, Java is a string that contains 4 characters, like this. So now we'll discuss how to store a value in a variable and how to extract that value for doing some computation. Suppose we have a variable and the variable name is age. So it is going to store only whole numbers or integers. We are assuming that age is a variable and it is going to store only whole numbers or integers. Now assume we want to store 60 in the variable age. So we want to store the value 60 in variable age. So we can do so by using an assignment statement, that is we can write age equal to 60. So if we write age equal to 60, 60 is going to store in the variable age. Let us consider another statement, that is equal to discount equal to bill into 0.07. So this statement, discount equal to bill multiplication 0.07, tells the computer to take the number stored in the variable bill and multiply that number with 0.07, and then store the result, that means the right side part, in the variable discount, like this. Previously 60 was stored in variable age. Now the value of bill is multiplied with 0.07 and the result is going to be stored in discount. So I hope up to this is clear to everyone. So now we will move to control structure. So generally, computer follows instructions sequentially as they appear in a program. Suppose for example, we have instruction 1, instruction 2, then instruction 3, instruction 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, like this. We have instruction 11, 12, 13, like this. So generally, first the instruction 1 gets executed, then instruction 2 gets executed, then instruction 3, and so on. So however, in some cases it is required to change the order of execution or flow of control. Suppose for example, in some cases it is required to execute instruction 11, execute instruction 11 after instruction 3. So in some cases it is required like this. So control structure changes this flow of control as per the requirement. So when such requirements will come, control structure is going to deal with that. Basically, there are two basic types of control structure. One is loop, another one is branch, like we have written here. So one is loop, another one is branch. So loops allow to repeat a sequence of instructions multiple times. For example, suppose we want to execute instruction 3. Let us move to this example. Suppose we have instruction 1, instruction 2, instruction 3, like that. Suppose we want to execute instruction 3 multiple times instead of once. So for this we can use loop, and the details of loop will be discussed later. So if you are getting any doubt, so we will discuss the details of loop in future. So the next control structure is branches. So it allows the computer to decide between two or more different courses of action by testing a condition. For example, we can write if age greater than 60, that is for the senior citizen. So for senior citizens, the discount is 15%. Discount is 15%, and for others the discount is 7%. So we can write this in this way, like, or we can say it could be expressed using these statements like this: if age greater than 60, we can write discount equal to bill multiplication 0.15, else discount equal to bill multiplied with 0.07, like this. So for senior citizens, that means when age greater than 60, the discount is 15%, and for others the discount is 7%. So don't worry about the details for now, just remember that the computer tests a condition and decides the next course of action based on that. So here the condition is checked whether age is greater than 60 or not, and depending on that the course of action is decided. So now we'll move to subroutine. So large and complex programs are difficult to write. Subroutines provide a solution to manage such large programs by breaking them into small parts. We can break the large programs using subroutines, and we can write the program. Then subroutine consists of the instructions for performing some task, grouped together as a unit and given a name, like this we have written. So now consider a program to bake a cake. So in the previous lecture we have discussed that the program is a set of instructions. So the program to bake a cake program to bake a cake. So what are the steps? So in step one, pour flour in a bowl, then add 2 eggs or pour 2 eggs. In the same bowl, so these are the steps or program I'm writing. Then pour some milk, pour some milk in the same bowl. Then mix the ingredients . Then in step 5, pour the mix in a mold. Then step 6, cook for suppose 35 minutes. Then in step 7, let chill and the cake is ready. So assume this is our program and it consists of 7 steps. So if we want to break this program into small parts, we can do in this way. Like this is one part. So the first part is like 4 ingredients. We can consider this is one part. The second part is mix the ingredients and transfer the ingredients to the mold. And the third part is cook. So this is one part, second part is this, third part is this. So we can partition the program or break the program into 3 parts. So here pouring the ingredients parts, it consists of the step 1, step 2 and step 3. Here pour flour in a bowl, pour 2 eggs in the same bowl, pour some milk in the same bowl. So pouring the ingredients or pour ingredients consist of step 1, step 2 and step 3. Then mix and transfer consist of step 4 and step 5. That is, mix the ingredients, then pour the mix in a mold. Then the cook part consist of step 6 and step 7. So in this way we can break a program or a large program into small parts. Here it is a smaller one for your understanding. In the real life example, when we write large programs, we can break into small parts following this example. Okay, so now we'll move to programming paradigm. So variables, types, loops, branches and subroutines are the basis of traditional programming. So we have already discussed that part. Variables we have already discussed, like a box in memory, and types it determines what type of data we are going to store in the variable or the category of data that we want to store in the variable, like integers or floating point numbers or strings or characters like that. Then we have also discussed loops, that means when we want to execute a statement multiple times we need loop. Then we have also discussed about branches, that means when we need to select a single course of action between two or more different course of actions by testing a condition, we need branches. For example, we have discussed if for senior citizens the discount is 15% and for others the discount is 7%, like that. Then we have also discussed subroutines, that means partition a large program into small parts and then concentrate on the small parts. We have also taken a simple example how to partition the program to bake a cake into three parts. One is pour ingredients, the second one is mix and transport, the third one is cook. So here the large program that consists of seven steps is partitioned into three parts, or we can say is partitioned in pouring ingredients is a subroutine, mix and transfer is a subroutine, cook is a subroutine, and pour ingredient subroutine consist of step 1, 2, 3, mix and transfer subroutine consist of step 4 and 5, and cook subroutine consist of step 6 and 7. So these are the things we have already discussed. So these variables, types, loop, branches and subroutines are the basis of traditional programming. However, as program become larger, so when we need large program or we need to deal with large programs, programming paradigm is required to deal with the complexity. And programming paradigm deals with the organization of programming. So the programming paradigm deals with the organization of programming. So generally there are two paradigms that govern how a program is constructed. These are process oriented model and the next one is object oriented model. In process oriented model, programs are written around what is happening by a series of linear steps. So here the programs are written around what is happening by a series of linear steps. For example, baking a cake program discussed before. So here this one, this program. So what is happening? That is written using a series of linear step 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is all about process oriented model. So what is happening is written by a series of linear steps. Okay. Now we'll move to the next one, that is object oriented model. So first we'll discuss why object oriented model is required and if we follow process oriented model, what will be the problem. So the process oriented model is difficult when we are going to deal with large and complex programs. So the limitation of process oriented model is that it is difficult to deal with large and complex programs. So we need to discuss the object oriented model. In object oriented model, programs are written around who is being affected. So here in process oriented, what is happening here? Who is being affected? So programs are written in object oriented model around who is being affected. So following our baking a cake program, we can assume we have two cooks in the bakery. One is main cook, another one is assistant cook. So main cook is responsible for pour ingredients and cook. So this main cook is responsible for pour ingredients and cook. And the assistant cook is responsible for mix and transfer. So here we are writing in this way, like who are going to be affected or who is being affected. One is main cook and assistant cook, if we consider the program, baking a cake program. And main cook is responsible for pour ingredients and cook, and assistant cook is responsible or deals with mix and transfer. And the details about object oriented programming is harder to explain at this moment, so we'll discuss about the detail in future. So this is all about the object oriented model and process oriented model. So we'll stop at this point and discuss more in the next lecture.